Vice President, Intel Security, Chris Young.
Good morning, everyone. Hey, before I get started, let's give another round of applause to those award winners. Inspirational people for us in our industry. You know what, every year at the beginning of the year, I'm often intrigued by the headlines, those top 10 cybersecurity predictions for the coming years. We see headlines like cybersecurity skills shortage impacting our industry, or on a more somber note, attack on the enemy energy grid. This year, what if the presidential election was disrupted by a cyber attack? But you really think about it, in a lot of ways, we've become desensitized to those kinds of headlines. And I ask myself, I would ask all of us here, do we have the sense of urgency that we need to combat these problems or these potential headlines? What if they were true? What if they actually happened? What if this week the power went out in California and we couldn't have the RSA conference? That would change everything we're doing. Now, I know that everybody here at the conference, we're all working hard to try to make sure that that doesn't happen. But at an industry level, there's certainly more that we can do. There's many things that we could do together. So today, I wanted to focus on two areas, because I believe they're material to our long-term success as an industry, but they're also something that we can collectively address. They rise above anything that individual companies or people in the audience are involved in. These are initiatives I'm personally involved in, as well as Intel. The first one, it's all about threat intelligence sharing. Clearly, that's been a top-of-mind issue in our industry now for the last couple of years. We saw legislation passed last year into law, the CISA bill here in the United States. Now, before some of you, I can see you rolling your eyes right now saying, well, wait a minute, nothing's really happened. That's not going to really work. We've tried it. It doesn't happen. But we can do more. And today, let's talk about how we'll do that. The second area is solving our talent shortage. I totally agree with Amit. We need to stop whining and start making it happen for ourselves, because it's a problem that we've been admiring for a while in our industry. And the predictions, even if they're only partially true, point to the fact that we'll be in a world of hurt in our industry if we don't do something about the talent shortage starting right now. So we have to act now if we're going to make a difference for the future. So let's talk about threat intelligence sharing, because clearly it's going to be no surprise to anyone in this audience that our threats are more complex, they're more targeted, more customized often. What also strikes us is the volume has changed dramatically. One stat that stood out for me, I was talking to some of our labs team. In McAfee Labs, 10 years ago, we saw about 25 new threats a day. That's equivalent to the same number of buildings on just one block in Manhattan. Today, about 10 years later, we see about 500,000 new threats a day. That's equal to every building in the entire city of New York. And our response has got to be of equal scale if we're going to meet our adversary. Now, clearly, threat intelligence sharing is not a new topic for any of us in this audience. ISACs are a great example. We've been sharing in industry verticals for many years and doing so quite successfully. But there's a lot of limitations on what's happened so far or what hasn't happened so far. Through Intel, I've personally gotten involved in something called the Cyber Threat Alliance, where we've come together with some of our competitors to work on threat intelligence sharing. And we're doing this because we know that we've got to solve this problem one way or the other. So about 2 years ago, we got together and we started working as the CTA. And so what I wanted to do today is actually share with you some of what we've learned and offer a framework with three principles that I believe can help jumpstart and enable success in any threat intelligence sharing program. The first part, it all starts with focus. We started together and we said, hey, this is how we're going to do it. We're going to get together. We're going to stand up some servers. We're going to commit to sharing thousands of malware samples a day. And we put a bunch of raw data together. And guess what happened? Nothing. It wasn't actionable. We didn't improve anything for our customers. You know, we had a lot more data, we were doing some sharing, but our team that was involved said, hey, Chris, we're not getting enough out of this. And we when I reflect on that, we made a common mistake that I think comes up time and time again whenever this industry talks about threat intelligence sharing. Let's start by sharing everything, throwing all the data out there, and if we look at it hard enough, we'll find an answer in there somewhere. But it didn't work. It won't work, and it didn't work for us. Our collective power, even though many of us are quite large in the industry, wasn't enough to crack that nut. So what did we do? Here's what we did. We actually said we're going to flip this problem completely on its head. And we're going to start with a focus on a specific campaign, and we're going to work our way down from there. Not focus on the data itself, but focus on the answer to the question we were trying to ask. And by doing that, we actually started to learn something. We said, okay, we're going to pick Crypto Wall 3, just one campaign, one example of many, many we could have chosen. We tracked accounts. We saw that there were Bitcoin movements equivalent to about $325 million worth of value between the cyber criminals and their victims. We also pooled our resources as it related to the malware samples, the IOCs that we were finding. And what was interesting is that because we were all in different businesses, we had different customer bases, maybe operated differently in countries around the world, we each had something unique to contribute to the problem. And what we found out is that we could create countermeasures that beat each individual with the collective capability that we came together with. Each member was able to benefit because we were able to come together and share information. We even put that out in the industry as well. We actually published a white paper, we published all the IOCs that we found, we shared it on our website, we've done a number of briefings. So a number of you have started to benefit from that as well. In fact, we saw the hits on our website go from about 1,000 a day back in the summer to over 30,000 a day after we released the white paper, and that's been sustained for several months now. Google it right now, check it out. Or if you're from Microsoft, you can use Bing. It's mobile friendly, you can check out the website. But we put it out there because we want to give something to the industry that everyone can learn from. The second principle of the framework is that we have to redefine our business model, our competitive model, if you think about it. Because sharing as charity is not going to work at scale. It'll never happen. I believe that we can still compete. And we can differentiate, but not on the intelligence, the data itself, but on how we actually use it and put it into action. Others are trying to do this today. They're trying to bring together groups to share threat intelligence, and they're basing it on the premise that when everyone shares, everyone's more secure. The third piece of this framework is really about operationalizing the platform. You've got to have a platform. You can't just get together and put a bunch of data out there and hope that you're going to get a good answer. Because oftentimes when you get groups together, companies, people, et cetera, you're going to have free riders. And someone's going to complain about what's happening. And it's not an unusual problem. But through a platform where you've got the ability to score the exchange of information, you can actually start to enable different organizations to participate, public sector, private sector, large organizations or small organizations. Think about a scoring mechanism like this, where you're thinking, hey, I'm a small organization, a small company, I don't have a lot to contribute, but maybe you can go really deep on a specific focused subject, while somebody larger can give more breadth. And that value balance can be struck with the right scoring platform, the right mechanism. And we believe we found a good way to do that. And through that same platform, you can also begin to automate the way in which you turn the raw data or the raw intelligence into the countermeasures that actually need to be deployed. When I think about what we did with the CTA just on the Crypto Wall campaign, we were able to turn what we found into blocked IP addresses, dat file updates, signatures that we were able to deploy on the endpoints and the networks across the customer bases of our collective organizations. So that's protecting hundreds of millions of users around the world just through the small group of people that we have brought together in the CTA. The bottom line is the value of our threat intelligence is only as good as the countermeasures that it informs. And that's got to be our ultimate goal. These are the three elements. Try them. Put them to the test. I bet you'll get results. I know you'll get results. And we at the CTA, we're going to take this further. We're going to invest in this model because we believe in it as well. We're formalizing it. We want to add more members. We want more partners because we believe collectively we can create more value, not only for the industry, but for the people that we're trying to protect. Join us. Again, if you check out that website, you can see how to do that. It's a great opportunity for everyone to get involved. And our opportunity is to learn from all of you, because we don't have all the answers, but we're just getting started. And we think we have a good platform, but we want to bring more people on so that we can learn together and collectively move the bar for our industry. We're not going to solve the threat problem through intelligence sharing, but man, we can make a much bigger impact on the problem than any of us can do alone. Now let's talk talent. Today, the best estimates that we have for our industry are that in the US alone, there are over 200,000 unfilled cybersecurity positions. Now I'm from the state of Ohio, I'm a Buckeyes fan. That's the same size as two unfilled Ohio State stadiums. Pretty big, it's a lot of people if you've ever been there. But what's more dramatic to me is that by the year 2020, we expect the global cybersecurity talent shortage to approach nearly 2 million. That's about 20 Ohio State stadiums in size. Now, clearly, we've got options for dealing with this challenge, right? We certainly need to automate. That's something that all of us, I think, at this conference are pretty dedicated to. You don't have to go further than the RSA show floor out there to see that automation is key. We're all trying to figure out how we make our best men and women more efficient and effective as they do their jobs. But that's not going to be enough. We've got to get more people into the game. The way I like to think about it as a basketball fan is, how do I get more Steph Currys into cybersecurity? Because that's what we need. If anybody saw his three-point shot on Saturday night, you should check that one out too, because it's pretty amazing. We need that kind of performance in our industry if we're going to do something unique and make a real impact on our problem. But there's good hope on that front, actually. I think there's a lot of interesting things that are happening. Just yesterday, I was talking to one of our partners, BT, who's actually sponsoring a competition between MIT and Oxford University on cyber games. I was talking to another colleague of ours in the industry. She's been working with youth for a number of years. And I asked her, I said, Nico, how do you think we can get youth more interested in going after cybersecurity as a profession and getting involved in what we do every day? And she said, I think the answer is gaming. You know, youth love to game, young people love to play games. Let's get them involved in what we're doing. Let's make it fun for them. So, you know, I see what the SANS Institute is doing with the NetWars competition, and I applaud that. I think that's great because they're tapping into young talent, making cybersecurity interesting, and building that pipeline of potential cybersecurity professionals. And that's just one of a number of examples, but they're not enough yet. We got more work to do here. I'll give a second shout out to the White House this time. Their 2017 budget to create, amongst many other things, a cyber corps is key. It's something that many of you know I've been personally advocating for, and I've even written on the subject, so I'm really happy to see our government investing in really trying to build out that next generation of cybersecurity talent. But we can't forget that it's our collective mission. It's not just the mission of the government. It's not just the mission of SANS. It's all of our mission. We have to act now as an industry to solve the problem. Now, if I bring it down to a more personal level, I was thinking about this. As, you know, when I was in college, for example, there was no such thing as a cybersecurity degree or a major, and we weren't even really talking about it much. So through experiences in my career, through mentors, through working with people like Roland, or one of my mentors, Art Coviello, who won the Lifetime Achievement this award this morning, who, by the way, reminded us that strong security is critical for our industry, and that part of our responsibility is that we have to advocate and teach each other on how to make strong security work and balance that with our need for law enforcement. That's another part of our collective mission. Through mentorship, however, we can build that next generation of cybersecurity talent. So it's a goal that all of us can take. I don't care if you have limited resources, you do have expertise, and knowledge that you can bring to bear to help one come behind you. That's also why today I wanted to highlight some efforts that we've been doing at the university level. And I'm truly inspired by a particular program that's happening between the state of Indiana and Purdue University called Pathmaker. And I thought I'd share a little bit about their story right now.
Do you think about cybersecurity?
No, not very much.
I assume that I'm pretty safe.
I honestly don't really think about it.
I guess it'd be really easy to hack, but yeah.
I hope I don't get attacked.
It's a very big deal for the state to have citizens practicing bad cyber habits. They take those habits with them into their workplaces, and then they perhaps expose corporate company data. Being casual about security is no longer an option. And it's not just about protecting what's yours, it's about protecting your entire state.
I don't know a chief executive, I don't serve on a board where cybersecurity is not a top of mind issue.
I think you can make a very good case that there is a severe shortage of trained computing security professionals. And so what we offer here through Pathmaker is an opportunity for the state to provide a real service under its own direct supervision.
The facility is unique because it's one of the only places in the world that has a testing facility and incorporates that testing into the education for undergrads and graduate students alike. We find that serving the needs of the state with authentication and security is just one of the benefits that we bring.
I realized just how important it is that we have our online identities be something that we can control ourselves and something that we can protect.
What surprised me about these students is their thirst for knowledge and their willingness to put their entire energy into it while they're here.
It was a great opportunity to learn some experience and work with people with similar interests and get a leg up on the competition.
It's good for the student, it's great for the state, it's good for the companies, it's just a good solution all the way around. I think the onus is really on companies to make it clear the career opportunities available.
The state of Indiana is now a direct beneficiary. Our students are working in an operations center sited here at Purdue, which is working on the state's own cybersecurity issues.
There's so many problems that we still have yet to solve, and there's a lot of freedom to dig into these problems and find solutions and test things out and see what works. And it's such a critical issue for the world that it can really make a difference.
You know, when you meet some of the students in the video, you see that what's most important here is not the problem or the numbers, it's the people. And so I thought I'd actually bring some of those people a little bit closer to us all here at RSA. So help me welcome to the stage her first RSA conference ever, freshman at Purdue University, Morgan Marinick. Morgan. Morgan, it's great to have you here at RSA.
It's great to be here.
And I'm sure everybody loves to, everybody's gonna learn a lot from you today. Morgan, so we started the video out, and on the video we interviewed some students, your peers, and they didn't really seem to get cybersecurity as a problem or necessarily their role in it. How do we educate more young people on how they should think about cybersecurity in their lives?
I think a lot of it is the discourse. We need to adapt the security discourse to fit the modern era. We have students who are raised with technology, have had phones since they were 10, 5, and we need to adapt to that. They're used to having an online presence and online identity. And we interact differently with this technology. I have friends who will give their phone password or even have their friend's fingerprint in their phone just because it's more convenient. And then they can text while their hands are busy. And there's this communal effort in technology where we're all working together. And I think that it's definitely shifting.
So Morgan, what got you interested in cybersecurity in particular?
So I'm really interested in cybersecurity because I had a bit of a unique cyber experience. I went to online high school And this high school was Stanford Online High School, and I was interacting with a global community from my home in Detroit, Michigan. And I was able to be in a virtual classroom, all on video. We had text chat where we all talked with one another, and we were working together, and I had friends discussing philosophy from Sweden and Alaska and China, and it was a real global community that gave me this ability to recognize that our online presence is very similar to our presence that we have in the real world, because my bonds with these people were no different from the bonds I have with my physical friends. It's still something that is important, and therefore my online presence was very important.
Now, as you've delved into cybersecurity in your studies, you're spending time, you know, in some of your free time actually working on cybersecurity problems as well, in particular biometrics. What is it about cybersecurity that really interests you, you know, when you really think about it?
I'm really interested in the problems. You can find the solution for every virus and every issue, and there will be another one tomorrow. And that's something that is a puzzle, and it's really interesting and gives a lot of opportunity that a lot of fields don't have. And there's never answers to all of the questions.
So, Morgan, how do we encourage more students to go into cybersecurity, or at least to think about it as something that they might do after they get out of college?
I think a lot of it is about the opportunities that students have and making them aware that these opportunities are out there. So when I'm working in the Biometric Center at Purdue, and when I tell my classmates that I'm doing this research, their response is, Purdue has a biometric center? So having that understanding and giving them the chance to delve into these topics, we're interested. This is a problem that's dear to our hearts. We live in a technological world, but students aren't being told that this is an option for them. And they need to be told this, and they need to be given these problems, because given the opportunities, we will take them. We want to delve into these issues.
So, Morgan, last question. Advice for the companies here at the conference. What can we do to make it an easier choice, to get more, encourage more people like you to join us?
Give opportunities to students and teach them that this is something they can do. We're capable and competent, and we can delve into these problems with a new mindset and fresh ideas. But a lot of times, we're not given that opportunity. As a freshman, when I went to the job fair, I was told by intelligence programs to come back when I was a junior, whereas other fields gave me the opportunity to talk with them and interact and learn more. And I think that having those opportunities early, I was given a very fortunate chance to work with the center as a freshman and already delve into this material. But a lot of students don't get this opportunity, and I think that we really need to start giving them that chance.
Morgan, I want to say thank you very much for joining us. It's great to have you here, and I hope that we'll see you at many more RSA conferences.
Thanks,
Morgan. Certainly, Morgan's an inspiration for me to find our industry on her own, and I think she can be an inspiration for all of us. Her story there about, hey, look, you know, when I showed up, I thought that, you know, I wanted to do something with cybersecurity. I went to seek out companies at the job fair, and they didn't have opportunities for me. Clearly, we have opportunities. We can't hire enough people to do what we need to do. So we've got to find ways to make sure we're really engaged in encouraging more Morgans to join us. Now, Purdue and the state of Indiana are just one example. There are many examples we need. We've got to take these kinds of examples nationally, outside of just one state and one university, even globally. And everybody here has a role to play in solving that problem. But we have to act. We have to do something with this, whether it's resources, technology, or if you're small, even expertise. Because the simple fact is, none of us can predict the future. We can't predict what's going to actually happen over the next year in our industry. But what we can do is we can come together. We can work together to make the headlines that we want to see a reality. By sharing threat intelligence in a meaningful way, we can get there. By solving the talent crisis, we can make an impact. If we work together, if we do this, our actions will speak louder than our words. I'm personally passionate about this, and I look forward to working with all of you. Thank you very much.